capital S, coming out of some places. Somebody's carrying a portable, somebody has opened the window and put loudspeaker on the windowsill to let all the world know that he's listening to the Beatles or something. And for me it was like the sound of some kind of alien army marching into town with banners unfolded. I knew that I was one of them, and I was absolutely mad with joy. Finally things are happening. Finally I found a place where I belong. Because that's my spirit. That's my feelings. I love it, I gotta be there. Because I have not changed since that day when I first heard it. I'm checking myself out and I'm the same person. I still have the same feelings. And that's what rock and roll did to me. It changed my life totally. And it changed Russia also. I don't know if there would be perestroika or glasnost and without rock and roll. Perestroika and everything else connected with it is, I think, the only way for Russia to continue its existence, because the country was breaking down, really, and it was in ruins before, but nobody was really talking about it. Everybody kind of was accepting it. And it was grinding to a halt. And Gorbachev came in and he did the only sensible thing, is trying to restructure it, to save the country. And all these new policies of glasnost, openness, everything, that's the only way to do it. Because the real thing is that, I'm not even talking about economy or stuff like this, the real thing is that people's spirit is totally broken. And that's the thing that hits me the hardest. Now that I'm able to compare, I see how incredible all the people whom I know could be, if not for this lack of self-confidence. I mean, I can understand this, because you cannot really be self-confident when you can be taken for interrogation at any given time, like it was happening in the 30s and the 40s under Stalin. Everybody was waiting for this knock on the door. And you're taken away and your relatives never hear about you. People still living under this shadow, in a way. But there is still a lot of fear in a lot of people. Practically in all of them. Probably there is still a lot of fear in me, also. I'm not really able to tell. I hope that it goes away, it dissipates. But probably in some dark corner of my psyche, something is lurking. I don't know. I hope to kill the bastard.
The postcard was written in a studio. I sat in a studio for a while, and words started to come to me. And I was trying my best to record them. It's like I'm a radio myself, and I tune into a certain frequency, and then the information starts to come through. So my work is just to discern the words and put them together in necessary order. This is a postcard from a person who is separated from something or somebody. Bands and their unofficial bands. Now the difference is a little bit blurred. Official bands work for any kind of official agency, organization, anything, get any equipment that they want, and they are able to update it constantly because state pays for it. It's not really theirs, but they're free to use it. And they're getting all the tours. They're getting all the bookings, everything. But if somebody won't like what they're doing, the band will be told, you don't need to do this song, or you better change this, you better change that. Unofficial bands, they were not able to play anywhere legally. Now there are a lot of ways for the band to perform and receive money for it. The first time I had a chance to meet Dave Stewart was in Los Angeles. I was working in the studio of one of the friends of mine, and Dave was living just across the road. So this guy told me maybe Dave Stewart will come in because he's kind of interested in meeting a live Russian. I said, great, because I admired the Eurythmics for a long time. It started that it was just an interesting band for me, and then it evolved into something much bigger because I started to feel some kind of a message in them. It had some kind of energy that really meant a lot to me and still means a lot to me. I would say that Eurythmics music changed my life in a lot of ways, and that's a big thing for me. So I was really thrilled by this idea that I can actually meet Dave Stewart. And he actually suggested that he may produce a couple of tracks. And I said, great. And I started to understand that we like the same music and have the same ideas. As I understood later, working with him and just hanging out with him, he actually plays a lot of things that would not seem out of place in Aquarium, on Aquarium album. Only he never uses them on the Eurythmics records, because with Eurythmics they're doing something different. But he's playing great acoustic guitar and all this like medieval things that I love. So I said to everybody concerned with the project, no, I don't want another producer. I think I'm going to work with Dave throughout this album. and it turned out great. The song Radio Silence was the only one that was written in Leningrad before I came over here to record. I kind of like the idea of these two words, radio silence. I think that what they signify to me is like a lot of people nowadays are being bombarded with information from every possible angle. And maybe it's wise to turn off the radio for a while and stay with yourself and just with people. In the 60s was that a lot of bands were playing English and American rock and roll, and everybody was singing in English, and when I tried to do it in Russian, it was just empty words, even worse than Tin Pan Alley. And I remember definitely I just heard John Lennon's Mother album, the first that he did after the Beatles, and I was
was going down the street thinking about the song God is a concept by which we measure our pain. And I said to myself, I think I said to myself, you can't sing a song like this with that level of sincerity in somebody's language. You should do it in your own language. So nobody was writing things like this in Russia. So I've taken this burden on myself and went home and really started thinking about the idea of writing Russian rock and roll songs that would mean something. And then I had to go here and start the same thing all over again, trying to create something in my second language. I don't think that, for example, English is better than Russian for rock and roll, or Russian is better for better than English for rock and roll. It's just that they kind of work on slightly different levels. Because, for example, like Rock Me Baby, you're definitely not able to say anything like this in Russian. Just that kind of words, they do not exist. On the other hand, there are a lot of things in Russian that you won't be able to do in English. A lot of people wanted to make me translate my like Russian hits into English and just say, you know, translate them and sing them. What can be easier? There is no way of doing it, because the sound of it, the feel of it, the texture of any word and its relation to this melody is absolutely different. So I can't say that anything is better or worse. They're slightly different, and that's what makes it interesting for me to try to take the same approach that I'm taking in Russia and use it within English language. You know, I like this album, really like it. And it's not American album. It's not a Russian album. It's something new. The Young Lions, Молодые львы in Russian. I wrote a song in the autumn of 86, I think. And that's pretty close to the way we were doing it in Russia. That's the only song that I've lifted from Aquarium and put onto this album.